Good afternoon. Thanks for coming to my workshop today. I hope you'll enjoy it. I hope I can keep you entertained enough to stay out of the post-lunch food coma that I have going on too. So I've noticed in the room, this side's darker, this side's brighter, and so there's more glare on the screen on this side, so it might be a little harder to read the code on the screen. But if you like being in the light, that's great. I'm gonna be sitting for a lot of this, and you won't see me past the podium, which is either a downside or a bonus. I'm not that pretty to look at, so you might wanna sit over there. So I'll give you a minute to move around if you want. There's instructions for the lab up on the screen. We won't need that for a little while, so you have some time to get that going, and if the Wi-Fi goes down, we'll have to live with that, I guess, sorry. So I'd just like to get a sense, how many of you consider yourselves relatively new Ruby programmers, like maybe less than a year? A few of you, and everyone else fairly experienced? I just kinda wanna know how much explanation we need to do on some of the stuff that we go through. Also, I'll try to explain things as we go. If you have questions, stop and ask. That'd be great. All right, so how many of you have had to deal with legacy code before? A lot of you. How many of you have written legacy code yourself? That'd be me too. I think we all have at some point. So this workshop is based on a code kata called the Gilded Rose kata. You can look it up online. It's a really cool kata. I love doing it. It's plain Ruby code. I'm not going to get into Rails here. You know, it's RailsConf, I know. But it's an exercise that's like bite-sized enough that we can run with it during the workshop a little bit. We probably won't get done. This is an hour and a half workshop. The schedule, the posted around the conference is a little bit unclear, but we actually end at 3:20, so just before the last talk slot. I'm happy to stay around after and ask questions. There's nobody else in the room after us, so we could stay late if you want, but I'm gonna plan to wrap up for 3:20, just so you can get to that last talk if you're planning to. And if you wanna hang around, I'd be happy to do that, although my colleague Adam Cuppy is speaking right after me, and I kinda wanna see his talk, so. But I can see it some other time if I have to. So anyway, so Gilded Rose Kata. We're starting a new job today, and we're working for the Gilded Rose Inn, and we're working on the inventory management system at the inn. If you play World of Warcraft, you recognize a lot of the references in this code. You'll probably have fun with it. So in our system, we have a bunch of items that we stock and we sell, and they all have a sell-in value, the number of days that we have to sell the item. All the items have a quality, and that quality degrades over time. It says how valuable the item is. And our system runs kind of like a batch process at the end of the day and updates both values for all of the items in the inventory. Okay, there is a spec. You do not need to read this wall of text. Just know that there is one. We have no clue if we can trust it. Documentation lies, right? You come onto a system where the spec was written months or years ago, the code may or may not reflect that. So this might give us a bit of an idea what the system's about and some of the rules in the system, but we can't trust it. We don't know if it's true. We don't know if the code matches it. So we can use it as a rough guide, but you don't want to put too much reliance on it because somebody's going to pull that out from under you at the wrong time. We have a constraint. There's a troll that works on the item class, and he does not share code ownership of his code. The actual kata description says that if you change this code, he will one-shot you, and you're dead. So we cannot touch the item class or the item's property. So that's a constraint. There's no collective code ownership on this team. This is not a workshop about how to deal with problem people on your team, so we won't cover that today, much as we probably would in a real team. Okay. Now, with legacy code, if it's running and working and you don't need to add features, there's no reason to touch it. So we're done, we can go. No, we have a new task. There's a new kind of item we're gonna support called conjured items, and conjured items degrade in quality twice as fast as normal items. So that's what's special about them, and that's what we have to support in our system. So the way I'm gonna structure this workshop, we'll do a little bit of presentation and demo. This is probably the most I'll talk at once in the whole workshop. We're gonna do some mob programming, and we're gonna do some small group pair individual work. I'm gonna really kind of play it by ear between those two. If the mob program is working and you guys are liking it, we'll keep doing it. If it's not working and you wanna kind of work on your own, that's cool too. If you wanna just take this kata, take the code and run with it for a while on your own and ask questions, I'm cool with that too. It's a really fun kata to work on. I love playing with it. So, but we're gonna start with mob programming. And so the way mob programming works, I'm not sure if you've heard of it, a guy by the name of Woody Zwill, I'm not sure I'm pronouncing his name right, kind of has been popularizing it a little bit. And the idea is, so pair programming, you have a driver role and a navigator role, so the person with the keyboard and the mouse is driving and the other person is navigating strategic direction, that kind of thing. With mob programming, you have one driver and everyone else is either a navigator or a researcher. So if like you need to look up an API call, somebody can have their computer and look it up. But there's one person actually typing the code, and that person is mostly typing what the other people are telling them to type. You know, oh, let's do this, and let's do that. And so I'm going to be the driver for this just because having to get different people up here working on my setup is probably not going to work well. And you're all going to tell me which direction to go. I'm going to be giving some guidance because I have a few points I'd like to get across this, but it's going to be pretty organic and really driven by the ideas that you come up with. I am going to try to steer things in certain directions. So how do we safely change legacy code? Anytime you have to touch legacy code, that's your question. It's like, I have to change this stuff, but this stuff's running in production. It's meeting somebody's needs. It's maybe making my business money, or it's helping people, whatever your application is doing. For all that legacy code is gross and nasty, it is working, mostly. It is doing something that is valuable for somebody, and you can't afford to break that, okay? So as much as you want to diss on the code when you look at it, remember that it's actually providing value. There is something there, and you have to respect that. And so a lot of people just say, hey, I'm just going to rewrite this mess. There's a lot of blood and sweat and tears that went into that code, and a lot of learned lessons that are hidden away in the mess. And when you do a rewrite, you forget about that stuff. So we need to respect that this code is actually doing something, and we need to be safe about changing it. If you work with legacy code, you need this book by Michael Feathers. It's called Working Effectively with Legacy Code. It's a few years old now, but it is gold. It is pure gold. There's so many good techniques in there. So in that book, he gives the legacy code algorithm, which we'll be following. The first thing you do is you identify change points. So you have a feature you need to add. You need to figure out, what can you change in the code? Where does this change need to happen? And then you need to find places where you can test. The way we safely change legacy code is we get tests around it. I should mention Feather's definition of legacy code is code without tests. The definition I like more is code that I didn't write, but really I think his is a little more politically correct, so we'll go with his. So you need to find test points. Then you need to break dependencies, because a lot of times the stuff you need to test is too tightly coupled to everything else in the system and you really can't get at it. Then you write the tests, then you make the changes and refactor the code. So I actually tweeted at Michael the other day because I was curious how he thought this book applied to something like Ruby, because Ruby you have things like metaprogramming and monkey patching, which, I mean, he was writing more about C++ and Java stuff, which don't have those tools. And so his response was, you put more effort into characterization testing than dependency breaking. The latter is trivial. So in Ruby, the dependency breaking is less onerous because you have power tools, but you still need to do some of it. But the characterization testing that we'll be talking about in a minute is the more important part. So I want to thank Michael for responding to me. That was cool. I had a slide up earlier. Here's the code for the workshop. You can clone that if you want to, if you haven't already. A couple of people were having problems with a couple of things, so I actually did just push up a change. I forgot to include rake in the gem file. So it's there if you're having a problem with that. But let's get to looking at the code. And before we do that, OSHA requires me to show you this warning. That's the Occupational Health and Safety Administration, if you're not from the States. I have to show you this warning because the code is really bad. All right, so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to do some mob programming, and we're going to write some characterization tests for the code. So let's, I'm going to sit down now, and we'll get into the code and take a look at it. All right, how's that font size in the back? Is it readable? Yeah? Awesome. Okay, and the color on white is good? Bigger? Bigger, yep. So unfortunately, RubyMine does not respond to Command Plus, so I have to do it the hard way.
You can actually do pinch to zoom.
Yeah. It works. Yeah. Can do what? Pinch to zoom. Oh, really? Oh, cool. How's that? I want to be able to get some code on the screen here, so I'm going to maximize that a little bit. All right, is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the item class that we're not allowed to touch. How much is that showing on your screen? That should be all right. Okay, so we just want to look at it and see what it's about. You see an item has a name, a cell, and an equality, just standard adder accessors. So this is essentially a struct and not much more than that. So like I said, we're not allowed to touch that because of the troll in the corner that we're not dealing with today. But it's there, and that's what it does. Let's look at the tests. That's all the tests we have to start with. This is how the kata comes. So it actually calls a method, but I don't see any checks in there. There's no shoulds, no expects, no nothing. So great, legacy code. And here's the code. So there's this Gilded Rose class. It has, we have our database hard-coded right in the initialize method. That's awesome. And then there's this update quality method that I will just scroll through. So don't try to study that yet. It's nasty. I call this wedgy code because of the shape of it, all the wedges, the triangles, whatever you want to call it. Okay, so that's what we're working on today. So the first thing we need to do, according to the legacy code algorithm, is we need to identify change points. So just kind of skimming through this code, what part does it look like we might have to change to be able to support conjured items? Update quality, that looks like a pretty good change point. Notice in our items collection, there is actually a conjured item already. We're going to guess that that's probably not being handled correctly yet. We don't know that, but probably not. But there is actually a conjured item in the database for us to work with, which is good. But update quality is our change point. So now we have to identify a test point. So what can we test about this method? There are no input parameters. We scroll down to the bottom, there's not really return value. So what can we test about this method? What's our test point? Items property? Yeah. Pretty much this whole method operates by side effects on the items collection. Okay. There is no getter for the items collection. So how are we going to get at that? There's basically at least three things I can think of. So the first obvious one is, well, let's just add a reader, right? Let's just drop that in up top like that. The problem is we just changed production code, and we have no tests for it. Now, sometimes that's what you have to do with legacy code because there just is not another option. But this is Ruby, and we have power tools. So let's not do that. I don't want to touch the production code until we have a safety net to work with. Instance variable get is the second way we can do it. And the third way, so I'm just going to make a let for the items because that's what we're going to be working with here. And we'll play with some ideas. So one of the ideas was instance variable get so that we can do if I could spell, that would be great. So we can do that. And there's one other way we could do this that we won't go with, but we could actually reopen items, and we could monkey patch it only for the tests. We could do that. So Ruby gives us some tools, whereas in other languages, we'd probably be forced to change some production code without the test safety net. So for today, we're going to go with the instance variable get, because I think that's probably the lowest impact one. But now we have the items. So there's our, what Michael Feathers calls these are sense points, things that you can sense about the application that you can actually write some assertions about. So that's great. So what's the first thing we should maybe test on this code? We don't want to study it. We don't know what it does yet. It's unfamiliar. All we're trying to do is get a safety net. So we want to go like really quick and dirty. The kinds of tests we're going to write here are not the kinds of tests you've been taught to write your whole career. Okay, these are going to be ugly and messy, and you're going to throw them away. Coraline Emke did a great talk at Mountain West Ruby, and part of her talk, she was talking about some of the testing you do on legacy code, and you basically write, you can write nasty, ugly tests, and once you get the code refactored so where you can write better tests, then you throw the ugly ones away. They're just there, a scaffolding to get to where you need to be. So we're probably going to do some anti-patterns and some gross stuff with the tests, and that's okay because it gets us to where we need to be. All right? So what might we want to test first? What's an idea? Okay, whether or not the items change in quality is good. I want to go even simpler than that. Why don't we even just test that we can actually get the information out of the items in the first place? So change nothing, run nothing. Just make sure that we can assert things about the items as they stand today. Does that sound okay? All right. So a lot of this talk is going to be, I'm going to be kind of insisting we go smaller baby steps, because once you know how to go really small, then you can handle any situation. Most of the time you won't go that small, but when you need to, you really can. That's a point that Kent Beck makes a lot. when he talks about programming. It's just sometimes you really need to go really small baby steps just to get through a tricky section, and then you can kind of take bigger steps later. All right, so all we're going to do is we're going to try to write a quick spec about the items. So I'm going to actually get rid of the test that's there that's a complete no-op, assuming I learned how to drive a keyboard today. So I'm going to do, these are going to be, actually, I'll just specify here. So after no updates, and these are going to be ugly RSpec tests, and that's okay. I'm using RSpec. I actually have Minitest in the repo if you prefer Minitest. I have a specific reason for using RSpec for this that we'll get to in a few minutes, but I'm kind of, I switch between the two a lot. I haven't decided which one I like the best yet. So let's just assert something about like the first item and that its quality hasn't changed. So let me split screen here real quick so that we can see both. I'm using RubyMine because I like the refactoring tools in it. You can use whatever editor you like. All right, so let's just take the first item and make sure that it's, I have to remember the order, sell in is first, then quality. So let's just make sure it's, we'll just write a couple of specs. They're going to be ugly, and that's okay because we're going to change them in a minute anyway. I got these backwards, didn't I? It's sell in first and quality second, right? Yep. Oh, let's reverse them and move that up. All right, so let's go ahead and run that spec. Okay, so it passes. We can actually sense the items now. Now, you can imagine what these tests are going to look like if we keep writing them like this. And so instead of continuing down this road and spending our whole workshop on it, I want to teach you about a different style of testing that that works really, really well for this kind of legacy code. Do we actually care about these numbers in this test? Do they matter at all right now? Do we care that they're right? Not at all. We just care that we don't change them. And so there's a style of testing. It's actually an anti-pattern, but for legacy code, it works great. So let me just flip back to Keynote real quick, 1 second. There we go. All right, so it's called golden master testing, or it's also known as the guru checks output anti-pattern. And so what the idea is that you get some output from a system, you have a human look it over and say, yep, that looks good. You save that off. The next time you run the test, you get the output out again. You compare the two. If they're the same, great, test passed. If they're different, then the test failed, and the human has to look at the output again. Now, the reason this is an anti-pattern is that the time you most need this test to be right is probably when you're making a change that you need to get into production to fix a critical bug. And at that point, the humans involved are going to be the most stressed they're ever going to be. And so to have them manually check the output at that time, really bad idea. It's a recipe for disaster. That's why this is an anti-pattern. But in this case, we're working with legacy code. We don't care if the output's right. We just care that we don't change it. And so golden master testing is awesome. We don't even have to look at the output to see if it's right. We just need to save it off as this is the master. If I change it, something broke, I need to back up and go again. So we're going to use this for this. And Katrina Owen wrote a gem called Approvals for this. I have to give a huge shout out to Katrina because I did a run through of this lab at a community college class last week, and there was just some things with the command line interface that I thought could be improved. So I like spent Friday, submitted like 4 pull requests to the gem. This is like last Friday. And that night she merged all 4 of them and I thanked her for it, and she goes, I said, that'll come in real handy at my workshop. And she goes, oh, you're using this next week? I'll cut a release for you right now. So Katrina is awesome. Thank you, Katrina, if you're watching this. So we're going to use her gem because it's really cool. So let's keep mob programming a little bit. And we're gonna bring in approvals. It's already in the gem file. And so the way it works, it actually interfaces really nicely with RSpec. So we're just gonna require it in. Okay, and I'm gonna change this after 0 updates test. Actually, I'll keep it running, but I'm gonna just throw an old on the end of it because I wanna write some new stuff using approvals. So we're gonna specify after 0 updates do. And so approvals has a method called verify that's kind of the main method that you use. And it takes a block. and all we're going to do is verify the items. And what it's going to do is it's going to save some representation of the items out to a file on disk, and remember that it's the golden master. And that's all we have to do to use this. So I'm going to go ahead and run this test. And it failed. And sorry, I wanted to blow that up. I do know how to drive RubyMine, I really do. Sorry, this font is really small. That is not right. I should have been getting a different, okay. These are just warnings, I guess. So here's the actual error. It's an approval error because I don't actually have a golden master copy yet. Okay, and that's expected the first time. So I'm gonna flip over to, not that, sorry. There we go, to a shell. And so what we can do is we can run bundle exec approvals verify. And so it's showing me a diff of the current approved copy and the new updated, or she calls it received copy. And it's added a bunch of lines. And we can say whether we want to approve that or not. So we're being the guru who's checking the output right now. And we're going to say, yep, looks good. Yes, go. Yep. Would that be better here? OK. Yeah, it's my turn. That's okay. I can flip it real quick. Is there a profile here? Yeah, there we go. Light background. Close it and reopen it. Okay. There we go. Is that better? Yeah, those colors aren't great, are they? All right, we won't be spending much time in the shell, so anyway, so. Okay. Oh yeah, we accepted that one, so it's good. And we go back to RubyMine, and we rerun our test. And it's still, oh, that's interesting. So I reran the test after we accepted the Golden Master. And we're still getting an approval error. It's not matching. Let's see if I can grow the text on here. Cool. Okay. And so let's go back and run approvals verify again. So the difference is these object IDs in here. Every time you run this, you're going to get different object IDs for the items. So we actually need to have our golden master output be a little bit less variable than this. So we need to do a little bit more work here. So I'm going to say, no, I don't want to approve that. And we'll flip back to RubyMine, and we'll just tweak our test just a little bit. So what I'm going to do, I want to zoom this particular window. Let me get rid of some stuff here. There we go. OK, so instead of just getting the items, I'm going to actually map that and just produce a string representation instead. And this will just be really simple. We'll make it a little bit human readable so that when we are actually looking at these, they make some sense. So I'm just going to do a really simple. I will push this up to GitHub so you can pull it down when we start working on this on our own, by the way, so you don't have to try to type everything I'm typing. All right, so we're just going to do a little string interpolation and get a string representation of each item in an array and let approvals work with that instead. So run that again, and again, we're getting an approval error, and we run our verify. All right, so now this time, we've got a little bit cleaner output that's not likely to change every time we run the test. So let's approve that as our new golden master. And we rerun the test. Why are you still red? Oh, undefined method cell in for name. What did I do wrong? What's that? Oh, that's right, too. Right, we have our new test. We can get rid of the old one. Thank you. There we go, green bar. OK. So now we have a test. It's not actually calling the code at all, but at least we know we can get the items out and we can run the test repeatedly and it's not failing every time we run it, which is good. That's a good first step, especially with legacy code. Sometimes it can take you a week to get to this point, honestly. So that's cool. So let's do an actual update here. This is going to get a little repetitive, but we'll fix that in a second. So the actual body is going to be almost exactly the same, but before we do the verify, we need to actually run our method. All right, so we're going to update quality and then verify the items after that. And again, that's going to use the Golden Master testing. We get our approval error. We go run our verify. And so now it's comparing after one update. Notice it's getting like subdirectories and test names from RSpec, which is really nice. If you run this in Minitest, you have to provide a couple extra arguments, which is one of the reasons I'm using RSpec for this. And it's showing the new output. Again, we don't care about what's in here. It doesn't matter if it's right. We just need to know we didn't change it. So I'm going to approve that. And we'll go back and run our specs again. And now we've got a green bar again. Okay. So we could keep doing this. How far should we go? How many of these tests do we need to write? Yep. That's one option. In this particular code, though, it keeps decreasing the cell in day, no matter how many times you run it. So yeah, that's a good idea. So his comment was that we run it until the output stops changing. So we run it until basically it gets everything all the way down. And that won't actually work in this case because cell in just keeps going down and down. It goes negative and keeps going negative. So we can't do that here. That would be a good thing to try, though. I just don't want to take the time in the workshop to do it right now. Until the values become invalid? Yeah. Yep. Yeah, they don't actually ever become invalid here. So that will never stop. So I want to introduce you to a little tool you've probably heard of. It's called SimpleCov that does code coverage. And what it does is you run your tests and it tells you how many lines of your code have executed or which ones have been executed and which ones haven't. So you can run this. I actually have it hooked in so it runs as part of the test all the time. It produces a directory called coverage that has index.html you can look at. But RubyMine has a nice integration for this. So I'm actually just going to run this test with coverage. And it pops up a little coverage window here that I'll try to maximize. And all we really care about is our Gilded Rose file, so I'm going to dive into that. Oh, there we go. So it's saying 67% lines covered. And if we go back to the code, it has actually, now I turned up the contrast on this. I hope you can see it down the left side. You see these green bars all the way down the left? Are those visible at all out there? Okay. If you scroll down a little bit, there's also some red bars there. So anything that's red is a line of code that has not been covered yet. Okay, so when I ran that test, all of these red lines of code have not yet been covered. It doesn't actually mark the ends and stuff like that. But so this gives us a sense of how much of our code has been covered. So at this point, we could say, you know, probably our tests aren't quite good enough yet to be really feel comfortable refactoring. So we should probably keep going. And this is another place where Ruby comes in really nice because we can just kind of, these tests are very, very similar. So I'm going to do them in a loop. So let's start with, let's go twice because that's what we're doing. So I'm just going to refactor the tests now. As long as the bar stays green, we're okay. Jillian did a talk yesterday. How many of you saw Jillian's talk on refactoring late yesterday afternoon? Anybody? She did a great job. And one of the points she made in that talk was that you should only be changing your code or your tests at the same time, never both, because your tests are your safety net for the code and vice versa. So we're going to change our tests a little bit. We're not going to touch the code while we do that. So we're going to just iterate two times. And within that, we're going to generate specify blocks here. Again, these are not tests you necessarily want to keep, but they're going to work for now. Okay, so all I'm doing is I'm going to repeat this loop twice, and I is going to start at 0 and then be 1, And then after that many updates, we run the update quality method that many times, so zero or one times, and then we run verify afterwards. So this should exactly duplicate the tests that we just had. Let's run them. And not quite. And the reason, if we look at it, it's another approval error. Couldn't find an after one updates.approved. So we had called our old one after one update because we actually used proper English in ours. We're going to go with that for now because, again, these are throwaway tests. They're just there to get us to where we need to be. So I'm going to run my approvals verify again. And I'm going to, I could actually, if I wanted to, spec fixtures. Just to be really safe. So I've got this after one update and after one updates. I could actually diff those two files just to make sure they really haven't changed other than the name. And there's no difference. So we're pretty sure we can do this. So now I'm going to run my verify again. Unfortunately, approvals doesn't actually back up the directory tree to the root, so you have to kind of get there yourself. That might be my next pull request to approvals. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and accept that. And we'll make sure we're green now. And we are. OK. So we already know that only doing one update only covers our code about 67%. So we could try two, and then three, and then four. I'm going to jump up a little bit. We'll go to five and try that, just to move things along a little bit. Again, we've got approval errors. Let's go verify those. So that's four, and three, and two, and green bar. And let's rerun with coverage again. And look at our code. So there's still some red bars in here. Just a few, but still a few. So let's try 10 times. So this is really kind of mindless. Just try to get enough coverage on the code to be comfortable with it. So we'll go 10, and we'll go approve everything. So there's five updates, and seven, and six, and eight, and nine. Now we're green, and run with coverage. So we're at 93% down here, it says. And if we look at our code, there's still this couple lines of code that are still not being covered. So I'm just going to bump it up. I happen to know that 20 works, so we'll just go ahead and do that. And go approve all those. Good. Okay, and one more time with coverage. So people talk about code coverage and whether it's useful or not, and you know whether you should shoot for 100% coverage or not. I'm not going to get into that debate a lot. It can be a handy metric to watch trends, but it shouldn't be the end goal. It should be a tool that you use in service of a more important goal. Okay. But now we are 100% covered. So how confident do we feel refactoring this code now with 100% code coverage? 50%? Anybody else? Okay, so if we're confident in our code, if I was to comment out, say, oh, I don't know, this line and this line, that should break something, right? No. We have 100% code coverage, but there's lines of code here that we can comment out and our tests don't fail. I don't know about you, but that scares me. What's really going on in this case, I won't dive too deep into it, is that there is an implicit else right here that is not shown in the code, and the else clause of this if statement is not actually ever getting hit. So code coverage is helpful, but it's not 100% reliable either. So you have to be careful with something like that. Okay. But for now, I'm going to call this good enough. So the problem why we're not covering all the lines of code is our tests are actually coupled to the predefined set of items in our initialize method. And those items in their current state do not exercise all of the possible cases in this code. And so this is actually a dependency that we ultimately want to break. But in order to break that dependency, we needed to have some test coverage, and we need to change the code. So we don't have a way to inject new items into this test very easily. I guess we could add some to the end of the array, but we're not allowed to touch that array because of the troll. So we have to work within the constraints we have. And so we're going to have to start changing production code without being 100% confident that we're not going to break anything. But we're pretty sure. I mean, these are pretty good tests. They're just not perfect. And I wanted to make sure that we pointed that out. OK. So now it's time to start cleaning up the mess. We have at least enough of a safety net that we're comfortable moving forward. So let's talk about how we're going to do that a little bit. I need to switch back to Keynote for a minute for that. Boom. OK, so we did that. All right, so I talked a little bit earlier about rewriting. We do not want to rewrite. Almost never is a rewrite a good idea. If you remember the browser wars back in the day, there was this thing called Netscape. They stopped the world to rewrite their browser and got completely destroyed by IE and didn't really come back until it was in the form of Firefox. And that took years. They did a stop the world rewrite on their code. It was just too crafty. We can't work in here anymore. And they died, basically. You know, Joel Spolsky writes about rewrites and how they're a horrible idea. Sometimes there's nothing else you can do, but I want to try to teach some tools that, you know, if you can't rewrite, what do you do instead? Sandy Metz actually did a talk here last year using the same kata, and she actually didn't refactor the code. She did an incremental rewrite on it. It was just very piece at a time, test-driven. It was great. It was an awesome talk. You need to watch it if you haven't seen it. But it was not actually a strict refactoring, and so I want to kind of go a different direction, and let's do this straight-up refactoring and see where we can get to. We may not get through it all today, given the time we have available, but we'll just see how far we can get with it. And we have to also remember, we're probably not going to get the code all the way cleaned up, but let's follow the Boy Scout rule and at least leave the code cleaner than we found it. We could go hack in this new feature right now, and the code would be worse. And that's not, if you have to keep coming back to this code, make it a little bit better every time, and over time, it will get better. The parts of your application you touch the most will become the cleanest parts of the application if you follow this rule. And that's huge. I mean, you can't stop the world for 3 weeks to clean code up, usually. So make the code a little bit better as you go. Okay. We're going to take baby steps. I talked about that already. We're not going to boil the ocean. We have to remember, we're trying to implement a feature here. We're paying down technical debt. We're taking longer than it would take to just write the feature in a clean system because of the mess it's in. But we have a feature to do, and so we can't lose sight of that. Now, because of the speed we'll go in the workshop, it'll seem like we're losing sight of it a little bit. But when you're working on your own code, keep in mind the end goal and the Boy Scout rule. So make it somewhat better. It might not be perfect yet. Make it better. Okay. So Kent Beck has a great suggestion for how to make changes to code. You make the change easy, which might be hard to do, and then you make the easy change. And that's kind of the approach we're going to take. And then when I was first researching, I actually did a talk on this kata at GoGuruko last year, and I found this quote while I was preparing for it, and I had to include it. So when you start a new programming job, you have to walk right up to the biggest function in the yard and refactor it in front of everyone. So that's kind of like prison advice, right? But that's what we're going to do. Update quality is the biggest function in the yard, so let's go refactor it. Okay, so we're going to keep going with the mob programming a little bit. Again, if you want to just kind of run off on the side on your own and play with this, feel free. Before we start refactoring, I'm actually going to commit the tests in their current state so that you can work from those. So let's go ahead and do that. And I have to keep resetting. So I'm actually going to create a new branch first called RailsConf 2015. Okay, and I need to add some files. That one. Oh, come on. There's. I always forget the shortcut for that. And the spec fixtures. Okay, those are all added. I'll go ahead and commit. And push, assuming Wi-Fi is working. All right, so you should be able to pull down that RailsConf 2015 branch if you want to kind of work on this on your own. For now, we'll just keep going with the mob programming a little bit, and then we'll see if you guys want to kind of do some pair small group work or keep going with the mobbing. Okay, so we have our tests. We really don't need to look at them again probably for now. So what we want to do, like I said, we want to stay focused. So there's some messes up here, but those aren't the core of the problem. Let's focus on update quality since that's where we know we need to make the change. Now, if I look at this code, I don't really want to, this is the least I'm ever going to know about this code, and this is not when I want to start making the huge changes because I don't understand it yet, and I don't want to study it for 3 days to figure it out. So what I want to do is do really simple, brain-dead seeming changes just to try to get a sense of the code. It's like a potter working with the clay and just kind of feeling the clay a little bit. It's kind of what we're doing with our medium here, which is the code. And so we're going to try to make really simple changes. And we want some sense of whether we're making the world a better place. So what I'm going to do is flip over to the terminal for a second. And I have a rake task called flog. And it runs a tool by Ryan Davis, who's speaking right after this workshop, actually, on Minitest. He wrote flog. And what it does is it basically gives you a sense of how ugly your code is. It runs something called a cyclomatic complexity analysis on it, which is a big phrase, but it basically tells you how gross your code is. Flog is actually a tool, I believe it's used by Code Climate, so part of your Code Climate score is what Flog says. So we're going to run this and just see where we're starting. So the overall code base has a score of 180.5, and the update quality method, as we surmise, is by far the worst. It's 155.1. So that's our starting point, and we're going to kind of see how we do against that as we go along. So let's flip back to the code. What's something really, really simple we can do to this code that would make it just a little bit better, a little easier to understand? Yep?
Change the items, so square brackets I to something else. So we will change the for something to items.each, and we can go to
the loop. OK, so actually make this an idiomatic Ruby each loop instead of this thing that was ported from C#. And so, but first you said do something with items I. OK, so I think I understand what you're saying. So I'll do a couple little mechanical things. Yeah, no, I understood the language. I just want to make sure I'm going the direction you're saying. So what he's saying is we need to do something with items I, like maybe extract it to a variable called item that would then become the iterator variable. So I'm going to do this baby steps like I talked about. So the first thing I'm going to do, now RubyMine has some refactorings, which is why I like using it. So we can actually go refactor extract variable. I usually use keyboard shortcuts for this, but I want to kind of show you where it is. And it says, do you want to replace all 34 occurrences of this expression? Yes, I think I really do. Thank you. So I'm going to call it item. Boom. We're going to run our tests. And I'm going to flip over and run flog again. That was a pretty big improvement. That was awesome. So that got our score down quite a bit. We've now left the code better. If we had to hack in our new feature, at least the code's a little bit better. But we don't have to hack in our new feature yet because we still have 45 minutes to go, so we can keep going. All right, so now you want us to turn this into an each loop instead, right? Okay, so does everybody feel pretty comfortable without refactoring at this point? Okay, should be reasonably safe, right? So the idea is we replace the for loop. So actually, before I do that, is that for loop really equivalent to items.each? How hard do you have to study it to figure that out? Kind of have to stare at it a little bit, right? It's like, what's the size minus one thing? Oh yeah, it's zero-based indexing. It's probably equivalent to an each, but you have to stare at it. And so one of the things I would like to argue is that idiomatic code, code written as native speak, is much easier to understand for new readers because you don't have to stare at it and figure out what it's really doing. You just know, oh, I know that idiom, great. Okay. So any place where you can make the code more idiomatic really improves the code. Okay. One of the things we did with that variable abstraction, we got rid of some duplication, but we also got rid of some noise in the code, and that also makes it easier to read. So, what's that?
You got a speed reduced because you don't need to go always into the array and already
right.
Variable.
We're writing Ruby. Do we care about speed? No, I'm kidding. Sorry, joking. But yeah, it is actually speed boost as well. So, So items.each do, and we'll call that item. And so that we should be able to get rid of those two lines and change nothing else. Broke something.
Instance variable.
Right, instance variable. Thank you. Test caught me. That's what they're there for. OK, so that's a green bar. That's another good refactoring. When I was teaching this to the community college class last week, they got completely addicted to running Flog all the time. It was hilarious. So that actually made it worse. That surprises me a little bit. I didn't expect that. But it's making it worse, and we're going to make it better in a minute. All right, what's something else we can do to this code just to try to get some noise out of there or make it a little more understandable so that we can add our feature? Extract the quality incrementer? OK, so like extract a method for it? OK. So what do you want to extract here? Just this one line? OK, we can do that. I want to point out this pattern and that pattern and that pattern. So that three-line fragment is repeated three times, and actually almost four, but not quite. So I've been through this code a lot, so I kind of know where some of the noise is. So that's almost the same, except there's a whole bunch of extra code in there as well. So it's not quite the same. Okay. So you want to extract. We can extract just the incrementer, or we can extract the whole three-line snippet. Which would you rather do? All three? OK. What do you want to call it? Increment item quality. OK. Increment or increase? Increase. OK. So RubyMine has a refactoring for this as well. It's called extract method. And I'm just going to use Command-Alt-M for that. And so it's going to be increase item quality. And it already figured out that I need to pass an item parameter to it. I'm going to say OK. And it's telling me in really, really small print there that it found two other code fragments that can be replaced with the call to this method. So I'm going to let it do that. And so it's actually prompting me for them. I could say do all, but I'll look at each one. So there's one, and there's another one. So it found the duplication for us and helped us extract it, which is really cool. I'm really not running an ad campaign for RubyMine, but I like the refactoring tools. I'm a small talk guy, and I just got addicted to refactoring tools, so I like it. All right, so we're still green bar. Now how's our flog score? That's significantly better. That was a good extraction, so that's cool. Still, update quality is the biggest rock, so we should keep looking at it a little bit. All right, anything else we can do to this to start to clean it up a little bit? We could do that. I'm not sure. It kind of makes that method a little more complicated. That's not a bad idea, though. So the suggestion is that we add a block to that method we just extracted to handle this last case where it does something after increasing quality. So in that case, when I think about stuff like that, I think, is it generally useful? Does it conflate the purpose of that method we just extracted? Because that method we extracted is really nice and clean and fairly single purpose. I said to ignore the spec early on, but if we go look at this for a second and go back to our spec, which is in the README here, one of the things it says is that quality of an item is never more than 50. So if that spec is actually accurate, it looks like we've actually captured part of a business rule in that method, which is good. The do something after that, maybe not so much. So in this case, I would probably lean towards not doing the block thing yet. But it's not a bad idea. It's a good idea. Just won't go down that road. All right, anything else? I'm kind of scrolling through this a little bit. You can look on your own screens. Max quality as a constant? Yeah, that's not a bad idea. OK. So this is actually a technique I've heard called active reading. So as you read the code and you understand something about it, capture that knowledge in the code itself. So by giving things good names, like we're doing here, we're actually capturing our understanding. And so the next person to come along, which is probably us in another week, doesn't have to study the code as hard to figure out what we learned. So we're basically capturing newly gained knowledge in the code. All right, so where do we have max quality? So we could global search and replace 50, but we might find a whole bunch of unrelated 50, so we have to think. So this one's comparing to quality, so we'll go ahead and use it there. And the only other 50 is down here, I think. Okay. Run that. I doubt that helped our flog score. Oh, it did a little bit, actually. Cool. Didn't expect that. So like I said, the students I taught last week got really addicted to flog. It's a tool like SimpleCov. Shooting for a certain number is probably not a good goal, but watching the trend can be useful. You don't want to make that the metric that you're going after because it's a metric in service of a bigger goal, so stay focused on that bigger goal. But in our case, it's a good kind of gauge to say, are we actually making the code better, at least by one particular measure? Yeah, Olivia? Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, that makes sense. Yep, question here? Okay. Yeah, you noticed that, did you? So notice we've been reading through the code a few times, and we're starting to pick up on some of these subtleties. I said early on, this is the least we'll ever know about this code. We're starting to see some of this ugliness and some of these weird things. Now, is that always zero? Item.quality minus item.quality, is that always zero? Unless what's negative quality? No. Subtracting a negative number adds it? Yep. So it seems like that's a safe refactoring. What if quality had a side effect? Then we could be shooting ourselves in the foot. So if quality had a side effect, I would have to hurt somebody, because that's not cool. But we looked at item, and it's just simple adder accessor, so we know it doesn't have a side effect. So we're going to say it's safe to do that refactoring and go ahead and replace that with a zero. And we have a green bar, so we're reasonably confident. Yeah, Alex. Okay. Okay, so you want to get rid of the parentheses? Oh, you saw that, did you? Yeah, I think this is a leftover from the port from C#, but a lot of times legacy code has been ported from another language, so you're going to run into this stuff in the wild sometimes. Get rid of the semicolon, run the tests. See, our tests run super fast, and so you can run them all the time. It's a great feedback loop. RubyMine actually has a feature where you can have it auto-run the test every time you save a file. It doesn't react fast enough for me. I want my little hit of green bar way sooner than that. So, all right, so we're going to go ahead and do this replacement. I think they're all safe to do. I probably didn't start it high enough to catch them all. Oh, whoops, didn't want to go quite that far. Exclude that one, replace that one. And I need to go back to the top and start that again. So I know if Ryan was here, he'd say I could do more. And replace all the method parameter ones too, but I'm not going to go quite that far. Yeah, that was too bad. I'm doing some I shouldn't be doing here. Okay. I got to fix a couple here. And then I got to get the closing ones. Not that one. Okay, I'm sure you can all tell me which ones I've messed up here. But so can my tests. Yeah, I messed one up. Anybody catch it? Right there. Okay, cool. All right, so somebody said they didn't think that would help flog. It actually does. I'm guessing because there's a rule in there about unnecessary punctuation or something like that. Also got rid of a bunch of yellow, which is cool. So RubyMine was also helping us find the ugly code.
Why
What's that? I could. That's a Seattle style versus not Seattle style thing, I guess. All right, let's take a vote. Who likes Seattle style with no parens anywhere? One. And who likes this style with parens in it? All right, mob wins. We're going to go mob rule here. It could go either way. I'm actually becoming more and more a fan of having as little noise in my code as possible, and so I actually may start doing an experiment with Seattle style, see if I like it. I find some Seattle style code just a little harder to parse, but I might get used to that. So that's my personal preference. I try to run little experiments like that a lot so I can make myself better all the time. So I probably will run that experiment pretty soon, at least on my own code. I won't do it to my team yet, but that's one thing that kata's are really good for, though, is you can really practice things that you can't really practice in your production code. They're just little simple coding exercises that don't take very long, but they help you really hone your craft a little bit, and that's a good thing. All right, what else can we do here? Sorry, I heard over here, what? Right, so this is another case where idiomatic code is more readable. So the suggestion is we use minus equals and plus equals here. Let me know if I miss any. And there's this one down here that we extracted already. All right, how's that? That's green, did I miss any? Okay, so that actually helped our flog total quite a bit, by the way. So the which one here? These three that I just changed? Yep. Yeah, there's actually only two because this one is selling. But you're right. Okay, so what Alex is suggesting is that we extract out this item quality decrement like we did with the increment. How much of that code do we want to extract? There's actually these two five-line snippets are identical. So do we want to extract that whole five-line snippet? Yeah, Olivier? Yes, do all five? Okay. Yeah, well, it's a pretty small step, just extract five lines into a method that's duplicated. So that's two reasons for doing it. So I want to take one other thing into consideration before we decide, and I will let you decide which way we go. We have this increase item quality method down here, and it compares quality and then increments it. And three of the five lines that we're talking about here have something very similar, kind of a very parallel structure. But they have this other item name check kind of interspersed with them. So is there something we could maybe do? So what I'm thinking is if we extract a decrease item quality method, parallelism and structure would be a really good thing there. And so maybe there's something we could do first. So what do you guys want to do? Yep.
Switch the check. So if item name is something, put it before the item quality or bigger than zero.
Okay.
So
okay, so what he's suggesting is that we swap these two lines right here. Is that a safe refactoring? Is that going to break our code?
There are no else, so it's...
Okay, he's saying there's no else, so it shouldn't break our code? Probably. Okay, all we're doing is stuff with item, and we already know the item just has simple accessors, so there's not side effects to worry about here. What's that? If there are side effects, that might be true. In this case, there's not, so we're reasonably confident this is safe. So everybody okay with trying that, swapping the two conditionals first and then doing the extraction? We have tests, right? What could possibly go wrong? So I'll swap those two lines and reformat, and I'll do the same thing up here as well. Okay, so let's run our tests. And I did it. What did I do?
The first part you swapped
around. Okay, undo. Yeah, you're right, I did. Okay. So that's the other thing about baby steps, is if you mess something up because you're not paying close enough attention or because you're live coding in front of 100 people or how many people are here, you can undo and you don't lose a lot of work when you undo. That's what's really nice about baby steps. If I was doing this for real, I'd probably be doing micro commits every time. I just don't want to take the whole workshop up with committing. I'll give you a link to a repo later where I actually did that. Like every micro commit I committed, it's like 76 to 80 commits on this kata. Just getting it to relatively clean code. Okay, so I messed up here, right? So what that actually tells me is that I actually took too big a step because I made two changes before I ran my tests. Okay, so this time I did it right. And that time I did it right. Okay, so now that we've done that, now we can do the extraction that we're talking about. And I'd argue that we should call this decrease item quality since this really parallels that other method. So let's do that. And there's one other code fragment, which is good. That's actually having RubyMine check that for you is good because it means that you actually made them duplicated and it found them. If you expect it to find one and it doesn't, then you know you might have done something wrong. So that's really handy. Okay, so now these two methods, what we're talking about, they're very parallel in structure, and that's a good thing because they're very similar concepts, just one's increasing, one's decreasing, and that's good. That's making the code more understandable. So check our tests, and let's see where we're at on flog. Down to 53 now, that's pretty good. All right, what's next? The which phrases? Yeah, all those strings are, yeah. We can make those constants. So you want to extract them out? Yeah. So let me flip over to README for a second. I don't normally do this refactoring this early, but you brought it up, so let's talk about it. So it's talking about things like aged brie and sulfura is a legendary item. So I'm just trying to get business terminology from here. Backstage passes. Does it really have to be only one band's backstage passes or all backstage passes? So we could actually make those tests a little bit more generic. I usually wait until I've gotten rid of the duplication in those names and then I do that, but we could do it now. Do you want to do it now or do you want to wait? It's up to you. It's what mob programming is. I'm doing a lot of navigating, but I'm supposed to be mostly driving. Okay. If we look at update quality, what responsibilities does it have right now? All of them, yes.
It's validating
quantity. What's that?
It's validating quantity.
It's validating quality, yeah. So the two main ones I'm thinking of right now is it's iterating over all the items and it's doing something to the items. And doing something to the items actually has multiple responsibilities as well. So what if we were to take the body of that loop out and make it its own method? So normally I actually do this refactoring a lot earlier, and there's a point I want to make, so that's why I'm suggesting it now. I think that's far enough. So I can extract method, and let's just call it update item, so singular. Okay, now look at update quality. That's pretty clean. And that gives us a really nice place to stand while we deal with the rest of the mess. So the main method of this class is now extremely readable. It's at a glance, you can see what it's doing. Yeah, Olivia, you had a question? You want to single line it? But that's not the Jim Wyra convention. All right, so single line. All right, did that actually work? Yes, it did. What did that do to our flog score? It is lower, and update item is now our worst offender, as we expected. But we're not going to take the time to do this, but I want to talk about this for a second. What we just did is we gave ourselves a test point where we've decoupled ourselves from the items collection in the class, because we have a method that we've left as a public method for now. we can now, in our tests, we can create an item, pass it into update item, and be reasonably confident. So we can make an item, all those corner cases that our 100% coverage didn't actually cover, we can now test those because we can construct an item with exact properties we need to test all of the cases on our code. So if we wanted to, at this point, we could stop the refactoring, go back to the tests, and write better tests, like, oh, this is what a normal item does, and this is what backstage passes do, and this is what aged brie does. We could go write all those tests, and they would look a lot more like TDD-style tests, maybe not totally, but they'd be a lot better than the Golden Master tests that we have now. So we don't have enough time in the workshop to actually do that, but I really want to point that out because that's huge. This gave us, we basically decoupled ourselves from the dependency on the items collection, which is one of the steps in the legacy code algorithm, removing dependencies. And that helps us write a lot better, more focused, more targeted tests. And that would actually be a huge improvement. In real life, that might be the next thing I do, is go write some better tests, because that would also help me understand the business rules better. I could actually write tests based on the spec and see if the code passes those tests based on the spec. That would give me some information. Or I might keep refactoring, which is what we'll do today. But yeah. Yeah.
So you know that nobody will take care about them because you change the API.
Right.
So when you prepare some tests for update item, how would you do those tests? Because mostly, I'm asking, you would like to test update item method very easily currently, but when you move it into private method, you will get messed up.
Right. So in that case, so the question is, normally, you don't want to change the API of your public API when you're doing refactoring like this. And so really, all of these methods that we've been extracting should be private. And so that would argue against using update item in our tests, because you don't test private methods. So what would I do with that? That's basically your question, right? So in this case, I'd probably leave it public temporarily. And I would look for a way to move most of its behavior onto other objects that I test, and test them over there. We're not quite to the point where we can do that yet. But, I mean, ideally, we'd extract a bunch of behavior over to item itself, but we can't touch that class right now. If we get far enough, we'll learn some tricks for that. So I would probably use this in its current state as a stepping stone to where I ultimately want to be. I have been known in the past in ugly code to just, like, put a commented out private above it just to communicate to the reader that, hey, I intend these to be private, but they're public for testing. Or I might say, you know, private but exposed for testing or something like that. Again, this is scaffolding to get to a better place, right? This is not greenfield code written the best way you know how to write it today. This is try to get it to a state where it's in better shape. What's that? You could do that too, put an underscore in front of it. Absolutely, yeah. I agree with you. I'm actually pretty big on, like, separating public and private API just for communication purposes, and I've been doing this for like more than 20 years, and I read Sandy Metz's book a couple years ago, and she completely rewired my brain. So after 20 years of, like, experience doing this stuff, and you read one book and it rewires your brain, that blows me away. That's how good that book is. And so I'm very much in that school now, where, yeah, private, public methods are what you test, private you don't. But in this case, there's so much stuff in that private method that I would probably leave it public for now and test it. And it's actually possible that this is a good addition to the API. I'd think about that a little bit too. You know, maybe being able to update a single item is actually a good thing for this API. I mean, this is really kind of almost doesn't deserve to be a class on its own, the Gilded Rose thing. It's probably will eventually go away. But yeah, it's an excellent point though.
You could test the private method instead.
Yeah, you can do that too. Yeah. I consider that cheating. But sometimes you have to cheat. All right, so what else can we do in here?
The if statement at the very top looks like it could kind of be combined with the three strings dot include item name.
So explain that. This condition at the top could be. Oh, I see what you mean. What's that? Yeah, I don't think so, but yeah. That's not a bad idea. I'm kind of trying to leave those conditionals for last. I want to get rid of all the other noise first and then deal with those conditionals. What's that again? Yep. Right. Yeah, actually, that's a good point. I was kind of ignoring this because we're focused on the place we need to change, but this is actually an interesting point. What does that line of code actually do? Exactly, it creates a class instance variable. This is not actually pre-declaring the items instance variable that we've been working with. This is actually dead code and confuses people, especially people who, I mean, class instance variables and things like that are a fairly tricky part of Ruby to start understanding. And so this is actually confusing new people. So let's just get rid of it entirely. That's a good point. It doesn't help us with our update item method, but it's good to get that noise out of there because it just doesn't distract people and doesn't confuse people. Something else we could do really easily is now that we've got our test coverage, we could actually put that adder reader in. We might not want to keep it forever, but for now, put the adder reader in, and then we could actually get rid of, let me do this way. No, wrong. I keep forgetting my keyboard shortcuts. There we go. We could use the reader there. Oops. There we go. And actually go back to our test and use it there if we wanted to as well. We don't need the instance variable get anymore. So that's pretty simple, and it gets rid of noise again. Again, getting the visual noise out of your way helps you really focus on the structure of the code. All right, so we've got a little over 15 minutes left to go here, and so I actually want to get to implementing our feature just so we can say we did. Normally, I would probably keep refactoring a little more because it's kind of hard to tell where to add that feature. Let's make sure we're green, and I'm going to go ahead run flog again. So we've gone from 155.1 on our worst method down to 45.1. So we've made the code better. Like I said, we can keep going, but I want to actually try to get the feature implemented. And at this point, I still don't see how to add it to this big, messy conditional. There's still more work that needs to be done there. And we may, if we have time after we do the feature, we'll come back and do some more on this. So for now, let's just do the ugly thing and handle the case of conjured items up at the top. And I want to establish a bit of a new pattern here. So conjured items, we're going to use a regex match instead and just say if the name has conjured in the title at all, then it's a conjured item. And we're going to early out when we're done and let everything else fall through to the rest of the code. Now this is making the code worse again, but it's still probably going to be better than where we started, so we followed the Boy Scout rule. At this point, we basically said, you know what, we had a time box for the refactoring we could do, we got as far as we could, the code is better, it's not great, but it's better. Now we really need to get this feature in, so let's get it in, okay? So this is going to fail because there is a conjured item in our list of items, and we've got a bunch of approvals warnings. We haven't handled conjured items properly yet. So let's go, actually we can write some more focused tests for that. So I'm gonna comment out the approval specs temporarily while we write some more targeted tests for conjured items. So let's do a describe conjured items. Okay, so let's flip over to what our spec says, which is that conjured items degrade in quality twice as fast as normal items. So normal items degrade by one every day. So conjured items have to go twice as fast as that. So we're going to have to do a 2 times decrease item quality on item. Okay. I could just go item.quality minus equals 2, but there's that protection against going below 0 that we don't want to miss. So we're going to do this ugly thing. This is going to suggest some more refactorings, by the way. But for now, let's just do that. and put the S on times would be really handy. Actually, I wrote this before I wrote my test. That was bad. So it decreases quality by 2 each day. Again, these might not be great specs, but so we're going to do a, and in here we're going to just make a single item. We're going to make use of that update item method that we have. So item.new conjured something. Don't care what it is. As long as it has conjured in the name, it'll be fine. Sell in can be 5, and quality can be 10. Doesn't really matter. So now we can actually do a TDD style test and write the test first and say what we expect to have happen. So what we expect to have happen is quality should go down by 2. And we could write this differently, actually. We could do the 2 change by. I'm not going to do that right now. But that would probably be better. So we're going to go guild or subject update item. And so we think it's going to go down by 2, so it should equal 8. Fix my white space because all right. And that actually failed. Oh, come on. Expected 8, got 10. So it didn't go down at all. Started at 10, stayed at 10. That's because we're not actually doing anything in our code. So let's go ahead and implement it now, which I had already kind of done. Okay, that's sort of green except of all the commented out specs for now. I'm just trying to focus down on this one spec. So the other thing that should happen is it should decrement the sell-in day by 1, right? And I should probably extract a before block here. Get that down there, and then here, so expect item.sellIn to equal 4. And that broke. Because I expected 4 and got 5, so we are not actually decreasing sell in. We need to do that. We don't have a method for sell in yet, so we'll just do the minus equals 1 thing. Okay, that passes. So there's one other business rule that we really should be covering here, which is that once the sell-by date is passed, quality degrades twice as fast. And so we need a test for that. So I'm going to context pass the sell-in date. I'm going to change what item is. Actually, let me do it this way instead. Because we can. Actually, I forget what order before blocks run in. Outer first, right? Yeah, never mind then. That would be bad. Let's make a new item here. Give it a name. Let sell in be minus 1. And quality can be 10 again. And so this time, so this before block is still going to run and update the item. It decreases twice as fast after the sell-in date. So expect item quality to equal, this time it should go down to 6 because it's going to go twice as fast. And run that spec, And we expected 6 but got 8 because we're only doing it once. So we get to do this again. Okay, and that's green. So now let's go turn all our other specs back on and see what broke. Because we expect them to have broken because we've changed our golden master output again. Because conjured items are now handled differently. Looks like we failed 4 specs, so let's go run our verify. All right, so after 1 update, quality is now 4 instead of 5. That sounds right. It went down twice as fast. So we're going to approve that one. And then after 3 updates, instead of being 3, it went down to 0. So it starts at 6. If we go look at our items collection, it starts at 6. So after 3 updates, it's going to drop to 0 because it's going twice as fast. So that's approved. After 2 updates, it's going to go instead of 4 to 2. That looks right. And after 4 updates, it's going to cap or bottom out at 0. It never goes below 0. And that's handled by our decrease item quality method. So that one looks right as well. We're going to approve that. But again, we had to be the guru checking the output. That's where the anti-pattern part comes in. But all those changes made sense. So we're going to run with them. OK, and we're still green. And now we are actually handling conjured items. Oh, not what I wanted to run. I wanted to run flog again. So we went back up on our flog score, but we are still quite a bit lower than where we started. And our new feature is now implemented. We followed the Boy Scout rule. We left the code cleaner than we found it. Not perfect yet by any stretch, but it's better. So let me just do a little bit of wrap up. I'll take some questions. And then if you want to stay for a little while and keep working on this, I'd be happy to do that. Or we can go to other talks. I've got one I wouldn't mind seeing, but I don't mind hanging around either if you want to stay in and keep playing with the refactoring. So let me just run through my last few slides here, and then we can decide what you want to do. All right, so we actually did a bunch of stuff. So I have a public service announcement. Please write tests for your code. Please don't make me work in your code base when there's no tests. All right, so if you want more, here's the original source of the kata. These slides are going to be up on speaker deck shortly. I did a talk on this kata at Gogoruko where I kind of walked through the way I refactored this code. There is a repo that I on my GitHub account where I basically I committed after every little small baby step refactoring that I did so that you can actually see the progression from start to finish and how far I got. If you want to try the kata on your own and see where you go with it before you look at mine, that'd be great because I don't want you to be colored by mine. I talked about Michael Feather's book, Working Effectively with Legacy Code. There's also Martin Fowler's refactoring book, which is a great catalog. He's also got a website with a lot of these refactorings on it. So if you want to learn more about refactoring, it's a great place to go. There are the gems that we worked on today, approvals. Again, I want to thank Katrina for turning those changes around really quick. I don't like to bug open source maintainers to kind of give priority to me. It's like they're volunteering. So I didn't ask her to, and she just, like, later that day, I submitted the pull request. She went in and merged them all, cut a release for me and everything. So I say thank you again to Katrina for that. Simple Cov is pretty cool. Again, the metrics tools and flog, don't treat those as your end goal. Treat them as tools to help you get to your end goal. All right, and again, you have the code repo that you saw there. I'll push this code up here in a second so you can get the latest. I'll have the slides up on speaker deck shortly. And if you want to give me some feedback on speaker 8, that'd be great. I always want to try to get better when I'm presenting, so any constructive feedback would be great. Thank you very much. So any...